It's alright, right when the pain come. It's alright, I can't complain, no. The sun shining down on me, yeah. Alright, right, right. First I'd like to thank my Lord and Savior. Take some time out.
Hallelujah! It's good to be in the house of the Lord again, isn't it? Amen, my brothers and sisters. Welcome to the New Ark Covenant Church, where we worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Amen? Let us pray. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, truly, 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 you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You are I am that I am. Nothing, Lord, can defeat you. You are the victorious, victorious God. Lord, we just thank you for this day. For this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. And although we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we shall fear no evil, because we know that you are with us. You are with us now, Lord. Have your way, Holy Spirit, in us and through us. For it's in the Lord Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Hit me. How y'all doing this evening? How y'all doing this evening? Do y'all want that bounce? Do y'all want that bounce? I say, do y'all want that bounce? That bounce?
Everybody wanna be like
Everybody say,
yeah.
a blessing.
Who
needs a blessing tonight? A blessing from the Lord.
Hello, my name is Nicodemus. The message this morning will be coming from the book of John. This message today is about me, the undercover believer. Jesus is looking for undercover believers. Are you one? As you listen to the messenger talk about my story, please listen and put yourself in my shoes. If you are not an undercover believer, don't ever become one. But if you are an undercover believer, then it's time to unmask and let the Lord Jesus Christ use you for his glory. The title of this morning's message is, It's Time to Unmask. If you would, please turn with me to the book of John, chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. No one can perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him. This morning, this story will bless you, my brothers and sisters. It would also challenge you. As we see in our story, the man named Nicodemus, he was a member of the Jewish ruling council, and he was a Pharisee. The Pharisees were a group of religious leaders whom Jesus and John the Baptist often criticized for being hypocrites. The Pharisees separated themselves from anything non-Jewish, and they carefully followed both the Old Testament and the oral traditions handed down through the generations. Before we move ahead, Holy Spirit needs you to understand that the laws of God, they have a purpose. There was a reason that God gave laws, but there were 10 laws that he gave, and the religious leaders began to place more laws in regards to the 10 that God had given them. And God gave these 10 commandments to Moses for the Israelites. The commandment's purpose was to show the people their sins, to show them right from wrong, not the means of salvation. The Ten Commandments was never the means for salvation. However, the Pharisees took it to another level by creating standards that they wanted the people to live by, which the Pharisees themselves did not keep. Hypocrites. And our man, Nicodemus, was a Pharisee. He was in the practice of allowing these laws to be placed on the people as a yoke. And he too was a hypocrite. There are 5 points to our message this morning. First, we see the legalistic views. Secondly, time to unmask. Then third, you'll see it's personal. Fourth, we'll see Nicodemus is convinced. And lastly, the gift. Legalistic views. The church has a problem with this, especially believers that don't read their word. There's a lot of believers, they just go to church, but they don't study the word of God. And the Bible says, study to show thyself approved. Study to show thyself approved of God, rightly dividing the word of truth. Here are some of the things you might hear the self-righteous say. Here are some of the things you might hear the self-righteous legalistic people may say. And here are some of the things you might hear the fundamentalists, the non-Bible carrying Pharisees of our day will say. They will say, thou shalt not drink alcohol and come to the Lord. Thou shalt not smoke cigarettes and come to the Lord. Thou shalt not smoke weed or crack and come to the Lord. Thou shalt not listen to secular music or dance and come to the Lord. They will say, you must keep the Ten Commandments to be saved. The Ten Commandments is not the gospel. The Ten Commandments were designed to show us that because we can't keep these Ten Commandments, we needed a Savior and that God would provide. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The glory of God is Jesus Christ, and he alone, when he walked on this earth, was perfect. None of us in here are perfect. You say, well, Pastor, I can come drinking my drink and smoking my cigarettes and snorting my crack, smoking my crack and come to the Lord. The Lord says, come as you are and let the Lord clean you up. Let the Lord change you. Everyone has been born in this world are sinners. We all got warts. Some people have warts here. Some people have warts here. Some people have warts here. And some people have warts here. And you sit on them. And nobody sees your warts as you think, as you might think. Sadly, many people are believing this lie the devil is telling the lost sinners. You have to get sin out of your life before you can be saved. And that's a lie straight from hell. You may be listening this morning and saying, you know, for some reason, I feel like I need to listen to this message. Stay tuned, my brother. Stay tuned, my sister. God wants to speak to you. Satan is trying to fool as many people as he can so they won't come to the Lord as they are. Again, come as you are. Wherever you're at in your life, if you're a stripper, come to the Lord as you are. And God will transform you and change you. The undercover believers will not come to church for fear that someone might criticize him or criticize her, or even worse, call them a hypocrite. And many people I witness to, they'll say that. Nah, man, I can't come to church, man. I got to get this out of my life. I got to stop smoking weed, you know. You don't know my life, you know. And I tell them, I say, come as you are. Bring the crack. Bring the coke. Bring the weed. Bring whatever is in your life right now that's displeasing to the Lord. Come, and God can change you. He's a miracle worker. This is the time to start kicking people like this to the curb. People that hold you back from coming to church. The only way you can clean up is when you come to the Lord and allow him to change your life for the better. It's time to unmask. Nicodemus knew it was time to unmask. Look at verse 2 of John chapter 3. Two words here. He came. Nicodemus came to Jesus at night. Nicodemus appears to come on the scene for the very first time in chapter 3 of John. However, if you really look at what's going on here, if you really look at John chapter 1, you'll see that Nicodemus was on the scene well before chapter 3 of John. John chapter 1, verse 29 through 34, when John the Baptist shouted, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. When John the Baptist baptized Jesus in the Jordan River and the Spirit came down from heaven as a dove and remained on Jesus, Nicodemus was there. Remember, Nicodemus was an undercover believer, and Nicodemus was checking everything out about Jesus Christ. He was checking out every one of his moves because he wanted to know who was this man, Jesus. When Jesus turned the water into wine at the wedding in Galilee, the undercover believer either heard what Jesus had done or he was there. Later in our message, we will see the Pharisees challenging Nicodemus as a follower of Jesus. His own religion, his own group are going to challenge him as if he was a follower of Jesus. Nicodemus recognized the power of Jesus. Nicodemus knew no one could perform the miraculous signs if God were not with him. It's time to unmask. I'm getting there, my brothers and sisters, because many of you are seeing some things. Many of you have experienced some things. Many of you have undercoverly prayed for some things, and God gave them to you, and yet you did not say, I prayed about this, and God blessed me. The Lord knows that there is an undercover believer watching this broadcast this morning. It's time to unmask. Woo! You've seen how God is changing people's lives. You see the very people that live in your family, lives are being changed. People on your jobs, they accept the Lord Jesus Christ, and they come in the job rejoicing and saying, I had a great experience. God came into my life. A young man, a young lady led me to the Lord, and now my life has changed. You've seen it, and yet you're acting like you didn't. And you may call yourself a believer, but you're undercover. You've seen how God is changing people's lives right before your very eyes. You were there. You were there. You went to a church service. The first level of openness to evil, verse 1 says that the blessed walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. We must guard our minds against ungodly counsel. Our mind is the first wall of defense. That's where it comes first. That attack comes in the mind first. Mm-hmm. Our mind is the first wall of defense against sin. We must lock the door to our minds to lock out this wicked power if we are to succeed. The battle takes place in the mind first. You know, I preach to me, and I'm here to tell you, I remember when I was not the blessed. I remember how miserable I was. And now that I'm blessed, I don't want to go back to that. But you got to step out in faith and say, Lord, I'm sick and tired. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I want to be blessed. I want to succeed. Then you got to hear the word of God this morning. What our mind feeds on is important. If you didn't get nothing else in the message, remember this. What our mind feeds on is important. If you feed your mind on mental junk food, you will live a junky life. If your mind's diet is music that promotes illicit sex, living the thug life, or dancing as a stripper, a dope dealer, or a porn star, then you will begin to live by these values. The second level of openness to evil, verse 1, still there, reminds us that the blessed does not stand in the path of sinners. The blessed does not behave as the world behaves. They don't stand in the path of sinners. They don't behave as the world behaves. Our lifestyle should announce that we are traveling in another direction. The righteous way is not just for Sunday strolls. It's not just coming to church on Sundays. It is a path for the rush hours, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. The third level of openness to evil, verse 1 still also says that the blessed does not sit in the seat of the scornful. Sitting implies total identification. Scoffers, we're going to change that word, scoffers are proud people. To sit with the proud implies a complete acceptance of their idolatrous points of views. By contrast, the blessed are wise. That's us, those who walk in the way of the Lord. They will not even consider the way of evil. We know that even looking on evil can be dangerous. It can break down our defenses. Its power can cause us to forget its immediate danger. Men and women of God, beware of fascination with sin. As the psalmist says, evil casts its spell if we allow it in our door. The blessed knows that evil must be avoided. To consider it is to be enticed by it. Even if you're just considering it, you're being enticed by it. Man, y'all need to stop playing with the devil. and need to start fighting them. Playing with them versus fighting them. Success comes from choosing what is good. Verse 2. We're off verse 1 now. We're just on verse 2. Verse 2 says, the blessed delight in the law of the Lord, and on his law, he meditates on it day and night. I meditate on the word all the time. And that is where I get my comfort, my peace. So what do we mean by the law? For the psalmist, it was the book of Moses, the first five books of the Bible. In verse 2, the psalmist merely repeat Moses' charge to Joshua. He says, this book of the law, Joshua, he talks to Joshua. He said, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night. Then you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you make your way prosperous. There it is. When you meditate on the word day and night, and when you put it into practice, then you will prosper. And then he says, and then you will have good success. Joshua 1:8. Go ahead and write it down. Go some. Remember this, Joshua 1:8. You don't have nothing to write it down with right now. Come back. You can rewind the message. You can pull up the message again and use a little red dot. You just stroll up there until you get to this part and write it down again. Joshua 1:8. More than anything, Moses wanted Joshua to be successful. Here, God telling Moses, you're not going into the promised land. He didn't get an attitude. He said, man, but I want you to be successful. My brothers and sisters, when I preach to you, I'm not mad at you. I want you to be successful. I want you to live a good life. And I know evil. I know evil will destroy you. And I know the devil hates you, but God loves you. I want you to succeed. But you know, it's funny how, you know, you get around the dinner table and you talk about the message and you say, you know, sometimes it seems like Pastor Fabian judgmental. No, I'm not. I'm coming from the word of God. I love you. I don't judge you. I'm just like you. I'm a sinner saved by grace. Who am I to judge? Let me get the log out my eye before I try to take the speck out your eye. But just listen to the word of God. Don't look at me, but listen to what Holy Spirit is telling you today. He wanted him to succeed. He didn't want him to fail. So Moses instructed Joshua to choose and cling to the revealed will of God as found in the law of God. Cling to it. Hold on to it and apply it to your life. For the believers in Christ Jesus, God's revealed will includes not only the Old Testament, but also the New Testament. Today we accept God's law as his entire word from Genesis to Revelation. The positive road to success for us as believers is to delight and meditate on God's word, the Bible. For us to meditate on God's word, we need to fill our minds with his word and read it carefully and daily. Give us this day our daily bread. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Daily eat that bread. Not just the bread for the physical, but bread for the spiritual. The positive road to success is to delight and meditate on God's word. For us to meditate on God's word, we need to fill our minds with his word daily. We should soak our thoughts in it daily as if we are taking a long, hot, bubbly eucalyptus bath with an aroma comes up in your nose and it relaxes you. We should let this heat open up our pores of our soul and let its cleansing, soothing, reviving take its effect. That's what the word of God will do to you, will soothe you. And I know when I get in my tub, I put the bubble in there and I get in there, I close my eyes, it feels so good. That's the way we have to read the word of God. How do we meditate on God's law? We take it in and let it have a permanent place in our thoughts. We repeat it until it becomes a part of us. Then we live it. When we read its instructions, we obey it so that our way becomes God's ways. The world we live in has little time for this type of meditation. The world wants action now. They have no time to spend in the Word of God. Is that you? Verse 3 portrays the blessed as a tree firmly planted by streams of water. Look at it. Verse 3 of our text. The person that's blessed is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. If you have ever planted trees, you know how much of them, you know how most of them flourish when there is an abundance of water. The tree in Psalm 1 was planted by streams of water. It had plenty of water and minerals at its disposal. Trees like this are successful. Trees like this are successful. Trees like this are successful, and they bear lots and lots and lots of fruit. It's a successful tree. When anyone drinks deeply from God's word, they shoot up into strong, sturdy Christians. We are rooted and able to stand firm and bear an abundance of fruits. The tree in Psalm 1 is subject to the seasons, though. The tree in Psalms 1 is subject to the seasons. The promise refers not to an absence of seasons, but to an absence of drought. It's planted by the water. In and out of season, the winter comes, but it's still planted by the waters. The hot, sunny days, they will come with no rain, but it's still planted by the waters. So it is with the righteous people. We are subject to the seasons of life. We go through many winters, yet the Lord sustains us from withering with living water. God gives us the Savior, who is Jesus Christ, his son, and he is our living water. Oh, look at John chapter 4, verse 14. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for blessing me. Thank you for blessing me. Thank you for blessing me. Woo! Thank you for blessing me, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. But whoever drinks the water I give them, Jesus says, will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. John 4:14, which I just read, applies to the blessed. Not the wicked, the blessed. The successful person in Psalms 1. But that brings us to the wicked person. The wicked person. Psalms chapter 1, verse 4. That's our text. Turn back there. Psalms 1, verse 4. Blessed, 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 blessed. The first three verses. But verse 4 says, not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. People will hear that, they don't think nothing about that. I don't care about that. God ain't gonna do nothing to me. Listen to what he said. The wicked can't stand in judgment, nor in the assembly of the righteous. You know, it's funny that when people aren't where they need to be spiritually, they can't stay in church. They can't wait to get out of church. It's just killing them. After describing the success of the righteous, verse 4 declares, the ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. The ungodly person goes in the exact opposite direction of the godly person. The righteous press towards the shining light of the city of David. The wicked run towards the darkness of the city of man. Look at Daniel chapter 6, verse 10. Daniel was told not to pray. because it was a decree. And there were some people that were jealous of Daniel. And the king said, then we'll have a decree that no one should pray to no other god, but they should worship me. So King Darius put the decree in writing. Now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room, where the windows opened towards Jerusalem. 3 times a day, he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God just as he had done before. Daniel opened his window towards Jerusalem. His gaze was on the holy city of God. His heart was set on worship. On the other hand, in Genesis 13, 12, you don't have to turn there, we find that Lot pitched his tent towards Sodom. He was fascinated with that wicked city. There's so many people that live in this city, Miami, as wicked as it is, are fascinated by it. And even those who don't live in this city are fascinated by this wicked city called Miami, South Beach, Miami Beach, Miami, Florida. Gotta go there. Gotta be there. Look at Genesis chapter 41, verse 33. And now let Pharaoh look for a discerning and wise man and put him in charge of the land of Egypt, Joseph is telling Pharaoh. Let Pharaoh appoint commissioners over the land to take a fifth of the harvest of Egypt during the 7 years of abundance. They should collect all the food of these good years that are coming and store up the grain under the authority of Pharaoh to be kept in the cities for food. This food should be held in reserve for the country to be using during the 7 years of famine that will come upon Egypt, so that the country may not be ruined by the famine. The plan seemed good to Pharaoh and to all his officials. So Pharaoh asked them, can we find anyone like this man Joseph is talking about, one in whom is the Spirit of God? Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, since God has made all this known to you, there's no one so discerning and wise as you. You shall be in charge of my palace, and all my people are to submit to your orders. Only with respect to the throne will I be greater than you. Woo! Boy, Joseph is up there now. Joseph is right up under the king. Promotion. All that he went through, all those roadblocks, he's still being promoted. His dreams are still coming true. They're coming into fruition. And you may be going through something right now. Roadblock after roadblock after roadblock after roadblock. Obstacle after obstacle. But God says, stay steadfast, my brother. Steadfast, my sister. Your dreams will come true. I believe that. So Pharaoh put Joseph in charge of this project. Joseph rose quickly to the top. From prison walls to Pharaoh's palace. First, he was to a lower man than the king, Potiphar, who was official of the king. But now he's next to the king. His preparation for his important position involved being first a slave, then a prisoner. In each situation, he was being prepared for his dream. This morning, whatever your situation is, don't give up on your dreams. It's part of the preparation for your dreams coming true. Oh, let me move. When we take heed to God's warning, we can avoid the consequences of misfortunes. Genesis 41, 53 through 57, turn there. 7 years of abundance in Egypt came to an end, and the 7 years of the famine began, just as Joseph had said. There was famine in all the other lands, but in the whole land of Egypt, there was food. When all Egypt began to feel the famine, the people cried to Pharaoh for food. Then Pharaoh told all the Egyptians, go to Joseph and do what he tells you. Hallelujah. When the famine had spread over the whole country, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold grain to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe throughout Egypt. And all the world came to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph because the famine was severe everywhere. Joseph's dreams come true. Bad dreams will come, but it doesn't mean that it has to ruin your dreams of great fortune. Joseph had many bumps in the road, but no matter how many bumps in the road, Joseph's dreams still came true. Joseph's dreams comes true. Look at Psalms 42:6. It says, now Joseph was the governor of the land, the person who sold grain to all its people. So when Joseph's brothers arrived, there it is, right there, 42:6, right there. His dream has come into fruition. Look, so when Joseph's brothers arrived, they bowed down to him with their faces to the ground. Good dreams do come true. Bad dreams will come. First point, good dreams do come true. Second point, bad dreams will come. This brings us to our last point, visions. God gives visions so that we can see that which has not happened yet as if it will soon be. I read that to you again. This brings us to our last point. God gives us visions so that we can see that which has not happened yet as if it will soon be. Visions is the ability to see details about something that is about to take place. This takes place in the spiritual realm. Visions, our last point. Many have experienced visions in the spiritual realm throughout the Bible. Here are just a few examples of men who experienced visions in the spiritual realm. Genesis 15:1, the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. The book of Acts, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ came to the Apostle Paul in a vision. Acts chapter 9, verse 10, John, another apostle of Jesus Christ, experienced the spirit realm through a vision in Revelations 9:17. Many times we as Christians have actually been in a vision. However, we think we are daydreaming. God brought us into a vision in the spiritual realm and we dismissed it as a daydream. Many times we as Christians have actually been in these visions. Don't dismiss it. The Apostle Peter received confirmation in a vision in the book of Acts on a rooftop. Acts 10, verse 9 through 19. Peter saw some things in a vision, heard the Lord's voice. Don't miss that. And Peter was told to do something. When you're still and you begin seeing yourself doing things that are good, you very well could be in a spiritual realm, experience a vision from the Lord, a vision from the Lord. In the days to come, Holy Spirit could take you into the spiritual realm and speak to you through a vision. Don't dismiss it as a daydream. As Holy Spirit was preparing this message, he took me into a vision. At this very point, while typing these very words, showing me how he was going to lead us all into a vision at this point of the service. God's going to take you to a vision. Everyone that's in this room right now, God's going to take you through a vision. Let me share with you quickly how you can go into the spiritual realm and see the vision God has for you. Right now, I want you right now, everybody in this room right now, I know you're busy, I know you're working, but God says, I'm going to take you into a vision right now. I want you, all you are at home right now, everybody, I want you to close your eyes. And I want you just to imagine yourself standing on the top of a mountain overlooking a great plain where the grass is very green and where beautiful tree leaves are blowing in the wind. Did you see that? Are you seeing it? With your eyes still closed. This is important. Everybody that's listening and looking at this broadcast, now without saying out loud with your mouth, only in your mind, I don't want nobody next to you to hear what you're getting ready to say. I want you to say your name in your mind, say your name. Only you should hear your name being said. If you heard your name, that was Holy Spirit saying your name, because you have been crucified with Christ. You no longer live, but now Christ now lives in you. You heard Holy Spirit saying your name. You were just in the spiritual realm. At this time, I want to pray that God take you into the spiritual realm and allow you to see his vision for your lives. And if the broadcast is all jacked up, don't worry about it. They went into a vision and they're not operating the equipment right now. But if you're at home and you hear my voice, I want you to do this. I want you to do this. I want those who want to operate in faith to close your eyes and allow the Lord to draw near to you and speak to your soul through a vision. You already heard him speaking. That's not going to be your voice. You're going to say, well, I can just say anything. No, the Holy Spirit's going to say it to you. Moments ago, you went into the spiritual realm and you seen and heard things. I'm going to pray that each one of you go deeper into the spiritual realm as Holy Spirit impart the ability to see your vision clearly without distractions or blurred vision. By faith, you got to believe this. His word tells us that we will dream dreams and see visions. Do you believe that? If you believe, begin right now envisioning yourself at a good place in your life. Start seeing it. Remember earlier in the message, I told you when I was a young boy, I used to make myself dream of being a boxer. I was able to dream that dream whenever I wanted. You could do that right now. This morning, you can see your dreams in a vision. Just close your eyes and create the dream in your spirit. Someone is here this morning. You can't see yourself delivered from a sin that has tormented you for a long time. By faith, this morning, come believing today. God will show you where he wants you. By faith, believe you will see God's plan for your life. Oh, I hope you're in faith doing this. In this vision, God wants to show you laughing, having joy that has eluded you for so long. That single mom, God wants to show you in a vision, you and your child with a wonderful man of God in your life. Visualize it. Know that God has given you that vision. That's a good thing. Single men, God wants you to see in the spiritual realm. You are being a great husband, a great provider for a great provider and a caring father. Visualize it. Today, someone is going to see in a vision themselves traveling all over the world with their spouse, enjoying the fruits of their labor. Someone is seeing in a vision an early retirement, no longer punching a time clock. I preached this message in the year 2008, many years ago, and this same vision about early retirement was my vision, and it has come to pass. I seen it on that day, and now I'm retired early. What a mighty God we serve. It came into fruition, and God is telling you right now, if it can happen to him, it can happen for you. There is a mother here who is about to embark on a business endeavor. God wants to show you in a vision. You are standing in your beautiful shop as a successful Christian businesswoman. That woman who has been single many years, envision being married again, traveling the world, and enjoying life. Are you seeing that, my sisters? Are you seeing that, my brothers? This morning, you are not daydreaming. You are not making these things up in your mind. Holy Spirit has directed you to see that vision. Know that God has said it in his word that we will see visions. That is what just took place. Dreams do come true. Continue to see the visions, my brothers and sisters. And remember, Do not give up on your dreams. You can look up now, my brothers and sisters. That was some good stuff y'all were looking at. Because good dreams do come true. And visions that God gives us do come true. I'm a witness of that. And I got one more that God showed me. And I'm going to share that with you because it's not a blessing unless I share it with you. It's coincidental if I don't show it to you. Share it with you. That last thing is God said I was going to be a millionaire. I stand on that vision. Now, I don't know what he showed y'all, but he showed me that. And just like everything that I have dreamt and that I have envisioned has come to pass. Great things for this church. We'll be out of here. We're going to move into a huge church. God has plans for us. He has given us vision, and I believe it. So with that being said, there may be someone that's an unbeliever. You don't get dreams from God. You don't have visions from God. But today you can begin to see those visions, see those dreams, and see those dreams come true. But I want you to pray this prayer so that that can happen for you. The prayer of salvation, receiving Jesus as your personal Savior. If that's you, I want you to pray this prayer with me. Say, Heavenly Father, I believe your Son Jesus Christ died on the cross for all my sins. And I receive him right now as my personal Savior. For it is in the Lord Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, the Lord Jesus Christ came into your heart and saved you. And now you can dream dreams, have visions, and they will come true. Amen. Man, I'm excited. I'm excited about what God has shown you. God bless you. Enjoy your Sunday. And we'll be here next Sunday, if the Lord's willing. God bless you all.
MJ of gospel, I moonwalk on the water. Ooh, I've been telling mountain moon, get on my way. I've been knocking down demons like a heavyweight. Roar of a lion, Judah, again, boom, babe. I'm talking real big, yeah, I got real faith. And even if I fall, I'll never hit the ground. I'm so high, you can never bring me down. And even if my enemies surround me, I'm not afraid. For a minute, while you're out here talking, oh. We get out here living, we get out in them streets, we be saving them souls. You ain't about that life, but if you want, let's go. I was beating my fist with my chest as I was making the sound. Gorilla faith, yeah, boy, I'm on my king.